In general, I return to, in this case, a dialogue between you and President Bush. I quote, Bush says to you, asks of you, with al-Qaeda in mind, what else can they do? And your response is NBC, which stands for?
Nuclear, biological, or chemical. I think when you're dealing with violent extremists who use terror as their means of getting their way politically, I mean, the thought that they could come up with fissile material, have a radiological device, or even a nuclear device that would create a nuclear explosion, or biological agents, it would, if they use those, it would they could be great, much greater tragedies than the 9/11 we saw. And that's what you have to, I think, have to worry about. These are ruthless and they're relentless.
So NBC also means WMD, weapons of mass destruction.
Right, exactly.
And the concern immediately was al-Qaeda may get their hands on those or may already have their hands on them and will use that against us.
Absolutely. And first of all, on that, going back to that day on September 11th, 2001, the thing that I was focused on, okay, well, what's next? Is this just the United States, or is this a worldwide attack that we're going to see unfold here? Is it running airplanes into things, or are there other weapons that are going to be used? All these questions, I mean, there's so much uncertainty. We knew pretty quickly that it was al-Qaeda. Fortunately, the CIA had the pictures, and they could correlate fairly quickly. But beyond
even
that—
Even though Osama bin Laden comes on or issues a tape a day or two later saying,
right,
we didn't do it.
We didn't do it, yeah. And then later takes great pride in saying we did do it, of course. But we had the pretty good evidence. The CIA had, the intelligence agencies had good evidence that was the case. But what was next? And so there's this aura of uncertainty that surrounds this whole question as we— I mean, that one meeting that day, we didn't decide a way forward. We didn't say, well, we got to go invade Afghanistan.
Well, from what little I know from my own contact with the world of military intellectuals, is that basically in a situation like that, you fall back upon the prudential principle and you deal in worst-case analysis. You dream up the worst that might happen, and then you have to sort of act on the assumption that it will happen unless you do something to prevent it or counter it.
Well, in one respect, we did that. We went to a different defense condition than we were at, just to raise the level of our alert and awareness. Not that we were going to have to strike anything, but more from a protective standpoint, and to put people on notice that we know we've been attacked. We know the president said very early, this is not a criminal act, this is war. And so there was a psychological component to that action. But you're right. Yeah.
And then the first ultimatum that is delivered isn't directly to Osama bin Laden, but is rather to the Mullah Omar, or at any rate, the Taliban chiefs in Afghanistan. And you tell them, give us bin Laden or we're going to come in and destroy you.
Right. The president was looking for a way beyond beyond military, or before military means were used, to try to get the Taliban to hand over the al-Qaeda. And,
but you gave them a deadline of about 2 days.
Right. They gave them enough time to think about it if they were serious. And I don't know if they took it serious or not, because after all, Afghanistan is a landlocked country. We don't have any we don't have the kind of relations with the surrounding countries that gives us a good logistics footprint. And therefore, you can't really do much until you get that logistics footprint in place. That was a lot of what frustrated us in the Clinton administration from going after Osama bin Laden. It was the same problem, this landlocked country. So we had to think through that. When the Taliban said no, then we had to continue with our planning.
You had to make some arrangements. It took all of a month or so.
It did take some time, and we found some good allies in Uzbekistan, in Kurdistan, and also in Pakistan. Pakistan, because of the Pressler Amendment earlier, which forbid essentially a military-to-military relationship, because of the nuclear testing that Pakistan was conducting at the time. We had lost generations of relationships with Pakistani officers. They didn't know us. We didn't know them. So we had to start that all up again. As you can imagine, there was great mistrust on their side.
With regard to our action in Afghanistan, there's a wonderful contrast, which you do make reference to, between what we achieved there in rather short order and the bogged down horror that the Soviets faced in Afghanistan. Probably the Soviet government fell when it did because of all the wreckage that they had brought upon themselves for some 10 years trying to control Afghanistan.
The Soviet Union at that point, at that time, approached it like a conventional war, and they were actually fighting an asymmetric war. We knew we were fighting folks, the more asymmetric part of it. So we decided to throw our lot in with the Northern Alliance, who had been fighting the Taliban for years. And the CIA had relationships with the Northern Alliance. Now, I got to tell you, as we were doing this planning, as Tommy Franks at Central Command, General Franks, was doing the planning, I mean, we didn't have 100% confidence this was going to work. We didn't know how willing the Northern Alliance was going to be. We didn't know how far they'd push. We didn't know if they'd push too far and decide they're going to try to rule the whole country. I mean, we did not know the end. But
who are the Northern Alliance? They differ ethnically from the rest of Afghanistan, don't they?
They do.
And, are they Pashtun?
Yes, and yeah. and they do differ ethnically, and they have, but they have their own groups of warlords.
Yeah.
And
their chief warlord was shot down in an assassination just 2 days before September 11th.
There was a reporter infiltrated his camp, and the reporter was an assassin, and the explosives were in the camera gear and killed him, Massoud. And he was supposedly, I mean, everything you read about him, he was a terrific leader. But so we threw our lot there. We used the one of the big discussions was, okay, who's going to be in charge? Is it going to be the Department of Defense? Is it going to be the CIA that's going to run this? The CIA had the better contacts. The Department of Defense had the more forces and the logistics to do it. And it was decided fairly quickly without any controversy. Okay, Department of Defense through General Franks, you're going to be in charge of this, and the CIA will support. And
we're going to come to Iraq shortly, but first, and we'll, staying with Afghanistan, one has to ask what happened after the rather rapid victory. And has that victory held? Is the government of Afghanistan in power to stay, or is the Taliban coming back? Because we read lately that the Taliban is gaining strength, and indeed some people are making deals with the Taliban.
Well, first of all, I think there's a lot of things that say Afghanistan's on the right track. They have a constitution. They elected a parliament. They elected their leadership. just the fact they had elections is a big deal. Mm-hmm. The fact that people risked their lives to have these elections. There were the story that I like, and I think I tell it in the book, in the province of Bamiyan in Afghanistan, the women were all told, if you go to vote, we're going to kill you. And mm-hmm. and pretty credible threat, because not too long before that, there was a minibus where they took everybody off, and if they had a voter registration card, they were shot. So the women, responding to this threat of Bamiyan province, bathed and dressed as if they're going to their own funeral, and then marched off to the polls. Now
they wore their Friday best, so to speak.
They did.
Friday's their Sabbath.
Yeah, right. And they did wear their best because they were prepared to die to vote. That tells you that there's something in the human spirit that I think endures in all of us. And they wanted a chance to have some say in their future. Having said that, Afghanistan is a terribly poor country. The literacy rate's reported to be around 70%, and they virtually have no infrastructure, few roads, power doesn't get out very far, and no water. So, you know, if you want farmers to not grow poppies and grow crops, they got to be able to get those crops to market. They got to be able to irrigate those crops. They have to have power to process the crops and so forth. And so there's a lot of – we're talking about probably decades of international help to make Afghanistan a viable nation. I don't like the word viable, but that's the best that comes to mind.
Of course, we're sending more American troops in
right
now.
Right.
What is the objective there?
I think the objective is that Taliban has been they've had a resurgence. They have the benefit of being able to go across the Pakistani border. And, I mean, for all intents and purposes, I don't think the tribes down there really care about the border. I mean, for thousands of years.
And the Pakistani government ceded them to the Taliban, that is, one of the northern provinces weeks ago.
And if you go back through history, the Pakistan has had virtually no control over the federally administrated tribal areas. So there are areas there where the Pakistani government doesn't have much influence. And so they have a safe haven, and that has to be worked with the Pakistani government, which at this time is going through its own stability problem. So, but the troops are going in to help with that Taliban resurgence, and that's probably a good thing to do.
Does the surge, as it was executed by General Petraeus in Iraq, is that the model for what we're now going to be doing in Afghanistan?
Well, I think it's a little bit different. The surge in Iraq was primarily to stop the sectarian violence and make the Iraqi people secure. The real brains of the strategy, in my view, was not necessarily putting more troops in there, but what those troops did. They needed more troops to protect the Iraqi population from themselves. The sectarian violence had gotten way out of hand since the Al-Qaeda, from the point the Al-Qaeda bombed this mosque in Samarra in February of 2006. And it went on for over a year before the surge, and then you were able to stop that violence. That was key. I think going after the Taliban is a noble thing, and raising the troops is fine. I think it has to be accompanied with political development. So the international community needs to help the Afghan government through its political maturation process, and also economic development. That's the only way. I mean, there has to be – the people need to feel that the central government is helpful. If they don't, the Taliban will be helpful. The Taliban will provide them their medicine. They'll tell them where to go to school. Of course, they'll exclude the girls, but they'll tell them where to go to school, and they'll provide for their needs.
And they'll tell you if you're a male to grow a beard, or they'll kill you.
Of course.
Strange people.
Yes. Yeah. And but the Afghan people, I found they want to do it themselves. The ones I've met all ethnic groups, I think. And they're very self-reliant. They're very hardy, as you can imagine. They live in a rough a rough country in a rough neighborhood. And I found them to be wonderful folks.